Morning. If I could take your Bibles and turn to Joshua chapter 24. Joshua chapter 24. You know, I believe in placing blame where blame belongs. But I just want to tell you at the beginning of this lesson this morning that Ron Webb is to blame for this lesson. 2 weeks ago when I preached before taking Mama up to Arkansas, I gave what I intended to be the last lesson on faithfulness. But when I introduced that lesson, I mentioned the fact that there were actually many more different aspects of faithfulness that I had encountered in my preparations for the Fruit of the Spirit study and that I thought were valuable. And he told me afterwards, he said, you know, no one says you have to quit just because the month changed. And Ron, I thought about that the whole time I was in Arkansas, and I decided that I at least had to do one more. And I'm going to use chapter 24 of Joshua for that text. There's so many, many related passages that I could use, but I think as far as one spot to find and incorporate several of these closing aspects, if you will, and especially what I consider the most significant and the reason why I was willing to break my own rule and go into another month with are found here in Joshua chapter 24. Yeah. Chapter 24 is in some ways a famous passage because it has that one verse where Joshua makes that great statement, "As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." And we'll talk about that statement this morning. But I personally feel that Joshua 24 is one of the great chapters of the entire Bible. I put it up right up there with John 6 and 1 Corinthians 15 and a few other chapters for significance in teaching. And yet, unfortunately, really that one statement is all most Christians know about the chapter. And because of that, they don't even know the context in which the chapter is given. I wish I could rehash everything that we've studied over the last few weeks about faithfulness. But obviously, time-wise, I can't do that. But let me remind you of the core definition that we've learned is the biblical definition of faithfulness. And that is lifelong loyalty and passionate love for the Lord. Revelation 2:10, and Jesus warns the church that they're about to go through, quote unquote, 10 days of testing. And of course, Revelation is a book of symbolism and especially of symbolic numbers. That 10 days there is not talking about 10 literal days. It's using 10 in the biblical sense of completeness. They're going to go through a period of time that is going to test their faithfulness. They're going to go through persecution, and they have to endure for that entire period of time. And so the last part of that verse is the one most people know, "Be faithful unto death, and I will give you a crown of life." But that whole verse and that whole chapter is talking about the persecution that they are undergoing and their need throughout it, throughout their lifetime, to remain passionately in love with God and loyal to God. And there is a key component to doing that, to accomplishing that. And that is my one overwhelming goal for the lesson. There are a lot of great things here in Joshua 24. And as time allows, I may touch lightly on some of them. But the most significant thing, and the thing that we're most concerned about this morning, is this one key component of faithfulness, of loyalty, of a lifetime of love for the Lord. And that is the concept of covenant renewal. Let me say that again, the concept of covenant renewal. This is a concept that is essential for for successful faithfulness in the biblical sense. And yet, I'm not sure that we have the understanding of this concept that we should. You know, because of our Exodus class beginning, we have recently talked about the covenant that God made with Abraham. And while there were different aspects of that covenant, the key aspect of that covenant was that all families of the earth will in you be blessed. And the reason why that's the key aspect is because what that covenant was all about was bringing Jesus, the Son of God, into the world to be that sacrifice for sin, to make, literally, to make forgiveness of sins possible. As the Hebrew writer would later put it, it's not possible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. So the perfect Lamb of God, His pure and holy and righteous Son, His innocent Son, had to be sacrificed to make that possible. And that has been God's goal for mankind since the beginning. That's why you can go back to Genesis 3:15 and see that promise of the singular seed to come. You know, because in that moment of the first sin became the necessity of forgiveness of sins in order to be in that home we just sang about, that place where there is no tears. That is the end goal. That is the reason, the purpose behind our faithfulness to God. Is so that one day we can be out of this world where hurricanes strike, out of this world where pains and agonies are experienced, out of this broken world where death claims us and our loved ones. We want to be in that eternal home with God, where the chastening rod is gone, where there are no tears shed. How are we going to accomplish that? Well, first we have to enter into that covenant relationship to God. And that's what we do by obeying the gospel. And that's why the culmination of obeying the gospel, it begins with hearing, it continues with belief in that message and in the Son of God as that sacrifice, and it moves to repentance and confession. But the culmination is baptism, and the reason is not that baptism is any more important than any other part of the plan. It's because baptism is the point in the plan at which we come in contact with the blood of the Lamb of God, the Son of God. And what a person who obeys the gospel is doing is entering into a covenant, quite literally. The covenants are given so we could understand this concept. Entering into a covenant with God, and the key blessing being bestowed is forgiveness. But one of the requirements of the covenant, and again, as we learned in our Exodus study, covenants are made between a superior power and a vassal power, a much lesser power. So between God and man, when you're talking about these biblical covenants, they have one overriding blessing. And for the new covenant, as Jesus said there when he instituted the Lord's Supper, it's forgiveness of sins. And they have requirements that superior power requires of that lesser or that vassal state or individual. And the requirement of our covenant with God is that we remain faithful unto death, that we have a lifelong love and loyalty to God. How do you do that? You see, that's what I want us to close out thankfulness with. How do you do that? You do that by covenant renewal. And throughout the Bible, whenever God gave a covenant, one of his requirements was that the people go through covenant renewal on a regular basis. And what that meant was that the covenant would be rehearsed in front of them, you know. So the understanding would be gone over again, and the purposes behind it, and the motivations behind it. And then the blessings involved in obeying the covenant would be rehearsed in front of them again. And then the punishments for not obeying the covenant would be rehearsed in front of them. In And then the choice would be laid out anew in front of them to either accept the covenant, which meant to obey the covenant and serve God, or to reject the covenant, which would be to experience the punishment of God. And that is all the Bible is, from Genesis to Revelation, and yet we struggle to understand that concept. And so here in Joshua 24, we're nearing the end of Joshua's life. This is Joshua's last recorded public action, is chapter 24. The last thing he did as a leader, you know, the book begins, Joshua 1:1, with the death of Moses and the leadership of God's people passing to Joshua. And so the book closes with Joshua at the end of his life, the end of his leadership of Israel. And what is his concern? His concern is that they keep the covenant. His concern is that they remain faithful to God. And so what does he do? He calls everyone to Shechem in the first 13 verses of Joshua 24. Shechem was a very significant place in their history. Great moments in the history of Israel happened there. It's where the covenant was given to Abraham. It's where the covenant was made with Jacob. It's where Jacob, before going to Bethel to worship God, called his people in a very similar fashion to what Joshua does here, into a covenant with God. Uses some of the exact same words that are here in Joshua chapter 24. On and on and on, the significance of Shechem. And so he calls them to this very significant historical place to renew the covenant. Verse 1 says, Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem and called for the elders of Israel, for their heads and their judges and their officers, and they presented themselves before God. As much as anything else that is necessary for covenant renewal, it is a remembrance of the fact that what we do each and every day, wherever we are, is before God. That means God witnesses it. That means God is in our presence. And it means that we must stay actively aware of that. And so for covenant renewal to take place, we have to remember that we are indeed before God as his people in this special and unique way. And then verses 2 through 13, I'm not going to take the time to read. I wish we had the time to read. But this is a key component of these types of ancient covenants. And it's a key component of the new covenant and of remaining loyal, faithful to them. And that is simply of rehearsing or remembering what God has done for you. And I remember, I didn't even put it in my notes this time. I hope it's ingrained on my brain, and I don't need it in my notes. But I do remember one of the first studies I ever did of Joshua chapter 24. And I remember what I wrote down. I can still see it handwritten on that paper at the end of that study. And it was the role of gratitude. You won't be, hear me, you won't be successful in living a life of faithfulness and loyalty to God if you don't have a proper attitude of gratitude for what God has done for you. If you don't keep that ever in front of you, if that's not the guiding principle of your life, is this is what God has done for me. And of course, we could list so many things, and each of us personally could list different things at different times in our life when we've seen God's mighty arm working for us. But again, most of all, what we need to remember is that he gave his son. He sacrificed his son to make forgiveness of sins for me, for you, a possibility. Something that could actually happen so that I could have that eternal home with him. And so those verses 2 through 13 literally just go through the history of Israel, and God says, this is what I did for you. I do want to read the closing verses, verses 12 and 13. Then I sent the hornet before you, and drove out the two kings of the Amorites from before you, but not by your sword or your bow. Now Israel, of course, did have to do some fighting to take possession of the promised land. But what God is stressing to them is they didn't win those battles because of their great warriorship. These were slaves. They weren't great warriors. And they were numerically challenged when it came to all of these peoples that inhabited the land of Canaan at that time. But they were successful in taking that land because of the actions of God, because of the power of God, because of the strength of God. Here's number two in what you must remember to be successful in covenant renewal. You must remember that you can't do it on your own. And as simple as that sounds, that is one of our great failings. We continue to strive for perfect obedience in our own power, in our own might, and it's never going to happen. The only way that we continue to be right with God is to continue to rely on God, to recognize our need for God, to recognize our need for the continual forgiveness in the blood of Christ, and to recognize His power, His might. That's why Paul gives that great passage in Ephesians 6 on the armor of God. You know, he's telling us as Christians, hey, you're not going to win the victory. You're not going to win the war unless you let God fight for you. And you fight with His weapons, and you fight His way. And so Joshua takes them through a lot of very specific detail in those verses that God kind of summarizes the warfare part in that statement about, I sent the hornet in front of you. Some people love to talk about God sending those hornets to defeat the enemy. That's not what it's talking about. It's hornet, singular. Do you notice that? It's not hornets. It's hornet. And it's simply a figurative, a poetic expression for the fear that God put in the hearts of their enemies that inhibited them in fighting with Israel. It's hard to be a good warrior if you're scared to death. And those people had the fear of the Lord placed in their hearts. My God, that's the hornet. And then look at verse 13. This is my favorite. I gave you a land on which you had not labored, and cities which you had not built, and you have lived in them. You are eating of vineyards and olive groves, which you did not plant. God, what are you saying? I'm saying that everything you have because of me. Do we realize, do we recognize that that's still true today? Everything that we have because of God. Because of His love, because of His power, because of His might. And to keep faithfulness, to renew that covenant on a regular basis and stay right with God, we've got to continue to remember that everything we have because of God. That solves so many of our dilemmas. It makes so many decisions for us. It helps us to walk in righteousness if we just remember that everything we have because of God. Now, if that passage sounds familiar to you, and Deuteronomy chapter 6, there's a longer passage. Again, we don't have time to go there. But there's a longer, more detailed passage in which Moses, speaking by inspiration, tells them the same thing before they enter the promised land. As they're about to go into the promised land, Moses says, you're going to go into this land. God's going to give it to you. You're going to have these houses that you didn't build. You're going to have fields you didn't plant. You're going to have wells you didn't dig. So that was a big part of survival in their world. Moses said, you're not going to have to go looking for water. Those wells are already there. The water is good. And he said, when you get there and you get to kick back and you get to relax, you're going to be tempted to forget about God. Why? For the same reason that when we're comfortable in the world today, When we're comfortable in the world today, we tend to forget about God. Why? Is it because we're terrible people per se? No. It's simply because when you feel like, hey, my own resources have provided me the roof over my head and the food that I eat, and when you feel like that, hey, if I have an unexpected bill come up, I've got the money in the bank to pay for it, what that does to you is take away from your recognition. It doesn't take away from your reliance on God. It simply takes away from your recognition of your reliance on God. And we tend to forget that we must have God, that we need God. And when we forget that we must have, that we need God, then our faithfulness will suffer. I heard about a man one time who was famous for his affairs, and he was asked by a reporter on one occasion, "Are you faithful to your wife?" And he looked at the reporter with a smile and he said, "Frequently." He thought he was being funny. But that's tragic. But I'm afraid too often that's our perspective of our discipleship. Are we faithful to God? Well, frequently. We see you either are or you are not. There is no in-between. There is no gray area. Either you're in a covenant relationship with God and you're faithful and loyal and love with God, or you are not. And when we forget our need for God, then it leads us into unfaithfulness. And so then you get to the heart of the chapter in verse 14. "Now therefore, because God has done all this for you, therefore fear the Lord." That's a phrase of preaching. I got to leave it alone this morning. "Fear the Lord and serve Him in sincerity and faithfulness." You see, this is Joshua's faithfulness, sir. That's literally what it is. Because of what God has done for you, serve the Lord. Don't forget that a key component of a covenant with God is service. And service, as we'll see in the text, is equivalent to obedience. So a key component of a covenant with God is my attitude of serving God, of being obedient to Him. And so serve Him in sincerity and faithfulness. Put away the gods which your fathers served beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. And that theme of service runs throughout the chapter and throughout the book, actually. What is necessary to remain faithful to God is to put away the gods of the world. If you don't get anything else out of the lesson this morning, that would be something to keep. That would be something to remember and to meditate on. I am not going to be faithful unto death if I don't put away the gods of the world. Watch how it plays out in the rest of the story. Verse 15. "If it is disagreeable in your sight to serve the Lord, choose for yourselves today whom you will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served which were beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." The people answered and said, Far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods." You see how that word just keeps coming up and up and up and up? But the word I really want you to notice is that word, forsake. When we talk about faithfulness, what is the opposite of faithfulness? It's forsaking. It's forsaking. And when we listen to the world, and we become involved with the gods of the world, then we wind up forsaking, we wind up failing to be faithful to God. I love what he did there in verse 15. I've got to point this out to you. Near the end of the verse, when he tells them that to choose who they want to serve. And if they're going to serve false gods, then their choices are two categories. They can serve the gods that their fathers once served in their ignorance, or when they were on the other side of your grace. That's the river. Some versions
talking about the Euphrates.
So you can serve the gods that your fathers served that were false gods, or you can serve the false gods that the Amorites who used to live in this land served. And in my Bible, I've highlighted who in whose land you are living. Because you see what he did there was tell them how useless false gods are. Think about it. Do you want to serve the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living? Why are they living in the land of the Amorites? Because the gods of the Amorites are deaf, dumb, powerless gods. The one true God gave that land to his people, to Israel, you see. So there's a rebuke in the statement that basically says, if you want to serve those guys, you're an idiot. Look how well they worked out for the Amorites. But of course, the key thing here, and it's always the key, is choice. The decision to live faithful is a choice. And it's a choice you have to make every day. You don't live a life of faithfulness in your marriage by standing in front of a crowd and a preacher on one occasion and saying, I love you. That's not how it works. You've got to get up every single day for the rest of your life and say, I love this person, and conform your actions to that statement. And yes, the statement comes first. See, our problem is we let the gods of the world tell us that the actions come first. Yeah. And so therefore we're in and out of love with one another. But love is a choice. Just like biblical faithfulness, biblical love is a choice, and then you conform your actions to the choice. And so you succeed, quote unquote, and fulfilling those marriage vows by every day getting up and choosing to fulfill those marriage vows. And you succeed in covenant renewal with God in a lifelong of faithful discipleship by getting up each day and choosing whom you will serve. And that question, the world and its ruler will put before you every single day of your life. Every single day of your life will be presented with that question of, what God will I serve? The gods of the world, the false gods, or the one true God who has done everything for me, and in most of all, has given his son for me. The people answered there in 16 and 17, as well as verse 18. And it all sounds good, doesn't it? We will serve the Lord. We remember what he's done for us. We will serve the Lord. Look at verse 19. Then Joshua said to the people, you will not be able to serve the Lord. This is one of the great parts of the chapter. He gives this great speech, and they respond in the affirmative. Why does he keep going there? Why does he say, you will not be able to serve the Lord? He is a holy God. He is a jealous God. He will not forgive your transgressions and your sins. Why that emphasis? Well, first, we need to think about that jealous God. Yeah. I've learned through the years that people don't like that language. And I've even read some scholars who said, you know, it's wrong to attribute jealousy to God because we think of jealousy only in a negative sense. But of course, because God is righteous, when you're talking about the jealousy of God, you're not talking about the negative. You are talking about the fact that he demands wholehearted devotion to him. That he demands that you put away the other God. That you cannot serve him and the false gods. But see, the problem has always been that the people of God have always told themselves that we can have both. And so we try and begin the world end of it. And so we try and serve God and the false gods. And when these people answer Joshua and say, oh, we'll remember all that God did for us, and we will serve him, Joshua knows
for this group, some of them literally still have their household idols, those physical things that they worship. And so they're both worshiping God and worshiping those idols. And we have to understand that that has never been acceptable to God, that He is a jealous God. He will not share you with anyone else. He will not share you with anything else. He must be your highest priority over anything or anyone in your life. And so he goes on to verse 20. If you forsake the Lord, there's that word again, and serve foreign gods, there's that other word, then he will turn and do you harm and consume you after he has done good to you. Joshua is calling them to a deeper commitment than the lip service of that first response. The people said to Joshua, no, but we will serve the Lord. See, that's that deeper commitment. And so Joshua says to them, you are witnesses against yourselves that you have chosen for yourselves the Lord to serve him. And they said, we are witnesses. So now he's going to bring it home to them. Now therefore, since this is what you said, you've made your choice, now you have to conform your actions to your words. Therefore, put away the foreign gods which are in your midst, and incline your hearts to the Lord, the God of Israel. That's the same thing we have to do. We have to put away the false gods in our midst. We have to do away with our divided loyalties. We have to put our focus and our emphasis on the one true God, and incline our hearts to Him. The people said, we will serve the Lord our God, and we will obey His voice. And you see the similarity between those two, serve and obey. So Joshua made a covenant. Now wait a minute, I thought they already had a covenant. This is covenant renewal. So Joshua made a covenant with the people that day and made for them a statue and an ordinance in Shechem. And Joshua wrote these words in the book of the law of God. And he took a large stone and set it up there under the oak that was by the sanctuary of the Lord. They got the tabernacle there at Shechem for this occasion. The tabernacle symbolized the presence of God. If you were educated, I guess that's the best word to use, in the Old Testament, verse 1 told you that they had the tabernacle there. And I say that just because there's a huge debate that rages in the academic world about whether the tabernacle was there. But it's very clear from the Bible itself, it is there. Remember, the tabernacle is portable. Now, they brought it there for this occasion. But that phrase in verse 1, before the Lord, that's the phrase that the Old Testament consistently uses for when they're gathering the tabernacle, because it symbolized the presence of God. That's why he gave it to them. And so they're before the Lord, the tabernacle is there. Joshua records the covenant and places it there as a witness. And he says in verse 27, behold, this stone shall be for a witness against us. For it has heard all the words of the Lord which he spoke to us. Thus it shall be for a witness against you, so that you do not deny your God. Then Joshua dismissed the people, each to his inheritance. Why did Joshua do? Why did God give him these instructions? Why write once again the covenant on the stone and place it there by the tabernacle in the presence of the Lord? Well, he tells us to be a witness. Now here's where we bring it home. God has given us two great memorials of the new covenant. The first we've already talked about. It's baptism. That's how we remember the sacrifice of Christ and enter into that covenant. The second, we observed when we took this supper. The second great memorial he gave us for the new covenant was the Lord's Supper. What time we've lost that.
Every first day of the week, is that a coincidence? You see what damaged men do when they come in with their own theories and practices and stop observing it on the first day of the week? And instead start observing it once a month, and then once a quarter, and finally for a lot of them once a year. Because we've lost the whole purpose of it. This is covenant renewal. It's those of us who obey the gospel being reminded of the fact that we entered into a covenant, that God is witness of that. And of choosing to renew that covenant. Does it matter if I miss the Lord's Supper? You see how foolish these kind of questions actually are when we really understand the Lord's Supper? When you miss the Lord's Supper, what'd you miss? You missed that objective choice and recognition that I'm going to continue to be with. That I continue to be in need of the forgiveness of sins that is only available through the blood of Jesus. And I will continue to be, to choose and to conform my actions to be a disciple of Jesus. And see, there's a great statement at the end of that verse, and it's in like three of the next six verses there, or maybe in 3 or 5, that talk about inheritance all of a sudden. I beg you to go home this afternoon. Put the football on DVR for a few minutes and read through chapter 24 and really see these words and especially see that closing section. Because all of a sudden, when it's all been covenant renewal, then all of a sudden it's about inheritance. Why is that? It's because of what we're learning in our Exodus class. Because the importance of all this is that God is. He alone is truly faithful. And that means he keeps his promises. Look at the record of Joshua's burial. Why is that given? Because of where he was buried. He was buried in his inheritance. He was buried in his own land. You see, the patriarchs, they didn't own that land. But they're buried there. We've already seen in our Exodus class the length that Jacob and Joseph both went to get buried there. They're buried there because they bought grape plots there because of the promises of God. But Joshua has that promise, that covenant promise fulfilled to him. And Eliezer there has that covenant promise fulfilled to him. And they're buried on their own land in their own inheritance. That's God saying, I do have that home in heaven. I do have that place where there are no tears. And I want you to be there. But you've got to enter into a covenant with me so that you can experience forgiveness of sins. And you've got to renew that covenant on a regular basis so that you can be faithful. You need to be washed in the blood this morning. Or if you need to be renewed in the blood this morning, I encourage you.